here in Nydia.
I'm meeting it now. I've read a lot about you, and I'm on your side 100%. I'm Sonny Bush.
Hello, in fact, Sonny Bush. It's a pleasure.
It's a pleasure to meet you. I was watching you at the commissioner's debate.
Here we have About for Sight and Miss Nydia Tisdale, and all the folks here in the audience. Yes, we have a nice crowd that's still coming in. Geoff Duncan, who is House Rep, District 26. So I want to thank all of them for showing up tonight. The format is going to be a three-minute opening statement from each of the candidates. We also have Justin Tomczak here, who is going to give an opening statement for Doug Collins, who was not able to make it tonight because of a prior engagement. But we invited him to make a statement, an opening and closing statement. We'll do 3-minute opening statements, 1-minute answers to each of the questions. Joe McDonald will be moderating the debate. Thank you, Joe. And then we will have 2-minute closing statements at the end of the debate. There should be some cards available in the audience. Okay, Ralph? Step up here in the front is going to make the pad available for additional questions from the audience. We have quite a few questions already, but feel free to submit questions in case we run out, or if there's a better question that comes from the audience than the ones that we already have, we'd be happy to put that one on the agenda. So with no further ado, I'd like to turn the meeting over to Joe.
All right, thank you very much. Candidates, as we go through this with the time limits, when you have 15 seconds left, I'll raise a yellow card. And then when you're out of time, I'll raise a red card. So we'll start going from left to right with the three minute openings. Jack, is there four?
Well, thank you. I appreciate everybody coming to the debate tonight and coming out on what appears to be a rainy night. Especially to the women in the audience who I know is probably wanting to get home and watch Dance with the Stars. I just want to say that it's been my privilege to serve Scythe County for the last 10 years. I've been here 29 years, a resident of Scythe County. This is a county that I love, I respect, I've watched it grow, and also my state. I love my state. I want to continue to do what I've been doing down in the state, and that's practicing my conservative values, making sure that we have less taxes. One of the goals is to do away with the income tax in the state. We looked at that this last year. We couldn't quite get there because in our economic time that we've got, you just can't cut out the income taxes without replacing some kind of revenue. But we did have some good revenue reform that's going to save us about $262 million to all the taxpayers in the state of Georgia. I look forward to doing what I can to make sure that the unemployment is done away with, not done away with, but greatly reduced in the county. It's I checked the other day, and I think the unemployment figure in the county is about 6.9%. Now, that's about 2% better than the state, and a lot better than the United States, but still has a long ways to go. You know, I like the unemployment figure to be somewhere around 3.5-4%, and I want to make sure that we achieve that goal and get back to that level in Scythe County. I want to continue to improve our school districts. Our school district is one of the best, if not the best, in the state. I want us to continue to work on that and do what we can to improve that. We have, over the last 6 years, received about $298 million in road funding for the county. And of course, when you look at that, you can see a lot of improvements that's went on in the county, and we made some real headway there. Probably about $375 million over the last 10 years. So I think that's a real plus. If we could just continue to work on 400, try to get the revenue up to take care of 400. Those of you that have to drive it every day, and I have to drive it quite a bit. I know it's frustrating. I would like to do something about that and, you know, take care of the 400 project. But make sure that we continue to have growth in this county, good productive growth. And I would appreciate your support and appreciate your continued support and vote. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Good evening, I'm Tom Knox, and I'm a candidate for the State House of Representatives, House District. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Turn those cell phones off. I'm Tom Knox, and I'm a candidate for the State House of Representatives, District 26. I've been honored to win election here in Forsyth County by the citizens of Forsyth County on six times. And you know, this is a county that has one of the highest educational levels in the entire state, has the highest average house price in the state of Georgia, and one of the highest in the United States. And it's the most Republican county in the state of Georgia. And it's one of the most Republican counties in the entire state of the United States. And I'm proud to have served as one of about 35 real conservatives in the State House of Representatives. I've lived on Lake Lanier since about 1984. I've had a house here. I've operated my own business, a law firm. In doing that, I've been fortunate to have good people working for me and happy to provide JOBS, a novel concept today, I know. I've been doing my part, continue to do my part to help the employment in Forsyth County and to serve the legal needs of the people of Forsyth County. And I'm proud to be a member of a profession that has a unique responsibility and a unique ability to defend both the state and the federal constitutions. I'm a member of the Georgia Republican Party, a member of the Forsyth County Tea Party. I'm a member of Americans for Prosperity, the Forsyth County Humane Society, the Tax Foundation, and I belong to the Lake Lanier Association, the NRA, and others. My wife and I attend Good Shepherd Church. We enjoy snow skiing in the winter, boating and sailing in the summer, the spring, the summer, and the fall. We enjoy spending a lot of our time with our five dogs, three of whom are rescues and two of whom are Yorkshire terriers. I'm proud to receive the Ronald Reagan Award from the Forsyth County Republican Party, amongst other prestigious awards. But I'm particularly proud to be here this evening to see old friends and to meet new friends and to answer your questions and to ask for your vote for Tom Knox for State House District 26. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Martha Zoller.
Yes, good evening. It's good to be back with you all, and thank you so much for having us all here tonight. I'm Martha Zoller, and I have been your conservative voice in Northeast Georgia for the last 16 years. This is a very important election because the American dream is under siege. And it's not about the 1% or the 99%. It is about whether you, your children, and grandchildren will have as good or better opportunities as you did. And Tom Graves and Paul Brown need reinforcements. Rob Woodall needs reinforcements to be able to go up to Washington and do the important work that has to be done. People say in this race that experience matters, but they're only talking about legislative experience. Well, I think there's other experience that matters. I think it's not time to send someone to Washington whose turn it is. It's time to send someone to Washington that's had business experience. I've worked in the corporate world where I started out as a gift wrapper at Rich's and moved up to a Group A executive level where I managed $10 million a year of other people's money. Then I married a man that had three little children, and I became an instant mother of three, and I stayed home with children, and we had a daughter. And let me tell you something, after I've raised four children, there's nothing Washington can show me that I can't handle. I also helped my husband run his medical practice over the last 22 years, and there's no business that has had more input, good and bad, from the federal government than a medical practice. And then I put together a media career where I have seen politicians on and off the record. I have seen the way they act when no one's looking, and I've seen the way they act when they think everyone is looking. I have seen how the sausage is made even though I haven't made it. And there are three important parts that we have here, and I have my Map for Prosperity out there that is our platform of action of what we are going to do to go in there. And we're going to have bold reform of things like tax code and spending. We're going to have accountability. If Congress isn't balancing a budget, they shouldn't be getting a full paycheck. I've been working on my budget the last few years, and it has gotten smaller. Congress's budget needs to do that too. We also have to have accountability and citizen engagement. I'm going to continue to include you all in what I do every single day when you send me to Congress. Today, I want you to get one of the Maps for Prosperity on your way out. You can log on to my website, marthaforcongress.com, and find out more. But I am your conservative voice. I'm the person that's been there with you in your living rooms, in your businesses, in many places throughout this district over the last 15 or 16 years. If you've had a group, if you needed help, I've been there. And I'm going to continue to take that kind of passion and hard work to Washington. I appreciate your vote on July 31st. I hope you go to marthaforcongress.com and get involved either by volunteering or being a part of things. And I appreciate the questions. I look forward to being here today. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Steve Voshall.
Good evening. My name is Steve Voshall, and I'm running for State Senate seat 27. I'm running because the citizens of Forsyth County deserve a senator who will represent them and their needs and not the needs of the special interest. We need a leader who will stand strong in the face of politics for what is right for the common family and who will lead others to do the same. Like you, I am tired of the disregard for ethics and fiscal common sense in our state government. I have lived in Forsyth with my family for the last 12 years. My children attend the local schools, play sports at the local parks, and I own a successful business here in Cumming. I founded and chaired the Forsyth County Tea Party for the last 2 years, and I'm a GOP precinct chair and captain, and I'm the state, district, and county delegate with the GOP. From working with my clients, most of who live and work in our county, I know firsthand the needs and issues that are on the minds of Forsyth County citizens. As a financial consultant and insurance agent, I have over 22 years of experience working with clients and assisting them with their finances. I have done so with the honor and knowledge of the great trust they put in me. I take my stewardship of other people's money very seriously. The current incumbent has been in the Senate for the last 6 years, and prior to that in the House for 4 years. During this time, our state has gone from a vibrant, healthy state to one with high unemployment, high college tuition rates, huge increases in foreclosures and bankruptcies. We also have the sad ownership of the state with the most bank failures in the country. Most of this has transpired in the last 3 to 4 years under the watch of the incumbent while he was the chairperson of the State Banking and Finance Committee. Yes, the state budget has been cut to satisfy the constitutionally required balanced budget, but what about the years when the state had extra funds? Why did we not pay off the debt, set aside reserves, lower the taxes for business owners? Currently, the citizens of Forsyth County are being represented based on special interest and political favoritism among longtime political politicians, not on what is in our best interest. This is not what we need from our next future senator. Thank you.
Geoff Duncan.
First of all, good evening. I'd like to take a minute and thank some very important people in the room tonight. First of all, I'd like to thank the Tea Party for hosting the event. And a lot of hard work goes into putting an event like this on, so I definitely appreciate your effort. Secondly, I want to thank the audience. And regardless of who you're here to support, you're obviously a supporter of this country and of the democratic process, and I thank you for that. Most importantly, I want to thank my family. Most of you have met my wife at some point. My wife, Brooke Duncan, is right here. Next to her is my 10-year-old son, Parker Duncan. Next to him is my 6-year-old son, Baylor Duncan. And at home is our 2-year-old, Ryder Duncan, and hopefully he's just about ready to go to sleep for the babysitter. So if you take nothing away from what I say this evening, please let it be the fact that my family means the world to me. One of the first public comments I made when I first entered this race was that this was not going to be just about winning an election. This was going to be about creating a movement. A movement that puts our kids' generation in front of our generation. A movement that requires our leaders to be leaders with energy, commitment, and character. A movement that says, enough is enough. We're nearly 7 months into our campaign, and I couldn't be any more pleased with the traction we're getting all over this county. I've met with literally hundreds and hundreds of people in our district and across the county, not just to get their votes, but to get their input and their concerns and their perspective. Because as a House rep member, it's our job to know the very needs of the people that voted us in each and every time we cast our vote down at the Capitol. Rest assured that I've listened to the people in the county and the district, and there's three main things that they want to have happen. They want an even better place to raise their families, an even better place to run their businesses, and an even better place to retire. Regardless of who wins this 26th district state house seat, they need to use those three line items as their sole job description. My resume looks a lot different than many of the other elected folks currently under the Gold Dome. No need to worry, I'm up for the challenge. I'm up for the challenge to represent the nearly 50,000 people in my district and the over 7,000 businesses within the county. I'm ready to represent them through the eyes of a faith-based, principled conservative who has a track record of being a successful small business owner right here in this county. This election is no different than thousands of other elections in recent years across this great country, where people are beginning to elect real people and not just real politicians. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And Doug Collins was not able to be here tonight, but Justin Tomczak is going to have an opening statement.
Well, it is an honor to be here. I want to thank you. Is this on?
Yep.
Yes, it is. Well, wonderful. Thank you all for having me. There's a great turnout tonight, and I thank the candidates that stand behind me for having the courage to step up and run for public office. We need more people to do that. We need more folks like here in the Tea Party to get involved and make a difference. It's an honor to be here tonight for Doug Collins. He's actually in the district tonight at a meet and greet, and so he couldn't be here, but it's an honor to be here. I stood here the last time for Tom Graves, who ran, and thanks to Forsyth County, he went to Congress and he's shaking things up there. We need somebody to go to Congress who can stand between Tom Graves and Paul Brown and Woodall down in the 7th and make a difference. Someone who can unite that group of guys that are up there shaking things up. We need somebody like Doug Collins. Doug's a former small business owner. He's a chaplain in the U.S. Air Force Reserves. He served in Iraq. He's a former minister, and he's currently in his third term in the Georgia House of Representatives. You know, it's easy to step up and run for office and call yourself a conservative. It's a different matter to have the record to back up those statements. Doug has that record. You look at this past legislative session, there's a few great examples of that. mandating drug testing for those who receive welfare, protecting our taxpayer dollars, overhauling the state's Open Meetings and Records Act to increase transparency, something that's critically important. Finally got zero-based budgeting through, very important. And all along, cutting the size of state government, reducing the amount of government jobs, and maintaining our taxes and not letting them go up. These are just a few pieces of legislation that back up Doug's record as a consistent conservative. The challenges and problems facing this nation are too great to just put anybody into that office. We need to put somebody up there who can day one stand with Tom Graves and Paul Brown and make a difference and begin to take this country back. It's easy to talk about your record, it's another to have it, and Doug has got it. I thank you for letting me speak. I think I'm within my 3 minutes. I'll encourage everybody to look at collinsleads.com. That's our website. Like us on Facebook. We've got over 2,000 supporters on there. I'll be hanging around. I believe I get a minute and a half or two at the end. And just an honor to be here on behalf of Doug Collins, our next congressman from the 9th District.
Thank you, Justin. And before we get started, I'd like to have Ralph Stepp come up and lead us in prayer.
I pull this prayer out of the Constitutional Convention in 1774. Please join me in prayer. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, high and mighty, King of kings and Lord of lords, who dost from thy throne behold all the dwellers on earth, and the reignest with power, supreme and uncontrolled over all kingdoms, empires, and governments, look down in mercy, we beseech thee, on these our American states, who have thrown themselves on thy gracious protection, desiring to be henceforth dependent only to thee. Take them, therefore, Heavenly Father, under thy nurturing care. All these things we ask in the name and through the merits of Jesus Christ, thy Son and our Savior. And the people said, Amen.
Thank you, Ralph. And also, if everybody would stand, I'd like to close the pledge. Pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, thank you, everybody. And candidates, as we go through these questions, remember that you have 1 minute to answer, and once again, the 45 second mark, I'll raise a yellow card, and then once your time is up, I'll raise a red card. And we'll start with you, Mr. Murphy, and then we'll go along the line as I ask these questions. The first question is regarding jobs, and what are your plans on creating jobs in our area and state? And Martha, from you, we'd like for you to address it at a national level.
Well, I can't speak to the national level too well. I'm not really friends with that administration, so I can't really talk to them about that. But in this area, I want us to create and bring in jobs. And in the state, we need to bring in good, viable jobs, jobs that will create, just as we've done with the Caterpillar organization and some others that has created 1,600 jobs, I think, at Caterpillar. There's another company that we brought in and created 1,300 just in the last couple of months. And in this particular area, we need to continue to keep our taxes low and attract good businesses into this area and go out and sell them and talk to them about what we can do and what we can offer in this area to get jobs here. And that's something that we need to continue to do. And I think that the Chamber has done a good job over the past couple of years in doing that.
Thank you. Tom?
I hope that the government doesn't do a whole lot to create jobs. The main thing the government can do is reduce the spending and reduce the taxes, and the jobs will come. Every time the government starts trying to create jobs, produce jobs, they end up running us into the ditch, just like they've done this last go-around. The best thing we can do is make it possible for the people who make jobs to have the money to be able to make them. And that means cutting spending, reducing the size of government, and lowering the taxes.
You know, on the federal level, it's very similar. What has to happen is we've got to have some reinforcements that are sent up to Congress so that we have a conservative majority in Congress. We're getting a lot done in Congress right now, but it's getting stacked up like cordwood in the Senate, and nothing's getting done there. And so we've got to change the Senate, and we've got to change the presidency. Okay, that's extremely important. But once we do that, we've got to cut spending, and everything's got to be on the table, not just defense. Because once we start doing the right things, the power of the American people is going to be unleashed. So we've got to cut spending. We've got to get regulation out of the way. At least 50% of regulation could be rolled out of the way. Some people say roll it back to 2008. I think we could roll it back a lot farther than that. And you could get rid of Sarbanes-Oxley, which was the knee-jerk reaction to the dot-com bubble. We could get rid of Obamacare. We could get rid of Dodd-Frank. But then finally, we've got to change the tax code. That's what's going to bring business back.
Thank you.
There's two main areas, regulation and taxes. We need to limit and do away with as much government regulation and lower taxes. Small businesses drive the economy of this country. We need to get out of the way of the small business owner and let them do what they do best, which is grow their businesses. Overregulation is hampering and costing millions of jobs across the country. Locally, water issues are a prime concern. We need to solve the water issues locally if we're going to recruit businesses. Sales taxes in our county, if we continue to raise sales taxes for SPLOST and for LOST and other things, then we are continuing to put ourselves at an economic disadvantage to our neighboring counties who don't have those taxes. Thank you.
The first thing I'd like to do is get out of the vicious cycle of just creating jobs for an election cycle and get back to creating jobs for generations. And there's a whole bunch of ways to do it. Obviously, we're all conservative here to one extent or another. We need to shrink the size of government. We need to control spending. But most importantly, we need to get government out of our way so that we can let the free market systems work. We've gone through this terrible downturn for 4+ years. We laid the groundwork for that almost a decade ago with some bad decisions, with easy lending, with easy money. We've got to go back to embracing free markets. Think about it. We get the best and brightest minds, and I'm representing this county, this district. So I'm going to talk through the eyes of somebody in this county. We get the best and brightest minds to go sit in the biggest boardrooms we can get them in, to be able to come in and talk people into starting their businesses here, moving their businesses here, because this is a great place to raise your family, it's a great place to run your business, and it's a great place to retire. Thank you.
So the second question, we'll start with Mr. Knox. How can Georgia and the United States stop the illegal immigration problem?
Well, I'm not sure how much Georgia can do about it, but we've attempted legislation at various times and going at it from various angles. But I think really what has to happen is we've got to close the borders. Nobody wants to do that. They didn't want to do it when the Republicans were running it because we had the housing bubble going on. We needed labor, so it was really easy to turn face the other direction. So we've got to close the border, and then we've got to make sure that the people that are here lawfully. And I think there's more than a couple ways to do that if we have the will to do it. But most of the people who are involved won't talk about it because it can be politically damaging in any election. We need to start doing it.
You know, this has been one of the greatest failures of the federal government over the last 15 years, is not securing our borders. We need to, number one, secure our borders. You can't do anything else. It's job one. You got to do first things first. You got to secure your borders. Then we've got to look at the visa process, because it's no better than it was on September 10th, 2001, as far as people overstaying their visas. It is something that we have to do. More people overstay their visas than come across the border, so it's something we've got to fix. And then I support some kind of a work permit that is not a path to citizenship, does not have benefits to go along with it, but allow farmers and others, because unfortunately we learned last summer that there were jobs Americans wouldn't do. when the governor tried, you know, heroically to try to get people to go down and work in the fields and did not have a great success with that. So we need to look at that. There's a lot more details in the map for prosperity if you go to MarthaForCongress.com, but it's an important issue and it's been one of the biggest failures of the federal government over the last 15 years.
Thank you.
Our two main sectors that drive our economy in our state are agriculture and manufacturing, both of which involve a lot of jobs that folks may not want to do. And that was being filled with by the illegal aliens. And we need to be careful when we design laws and bring in government to regulate things that we aren't causing businesses to go out of business, and that we aren't inadvertently costing more jobs and more money for small businesses. We need to secure the borders. Securing the borders with Mexico and with Canada are a federal issue. They need to be done. They need to be done quickly. We need work visas so that people can come here for agricultural manufacturing jobs if they can prove that they have a job to come here. And we need to streamline the system for citizenship. Thank you.
We can talk about this issue at the state level all we want, and it's important at the state level, but it first has got to be taken serious in Washington, D.C. We've got to secure the borders, but this is a national security issue. We've got borders that just don't bring in friendly people, okay? We need to address the borders. We need to address the visa process. It needs to be streamlined. It needs to be able to understand for small businesses. We don't want illegals working in these jobs. We want people, small business owners, many of you in this room, want the folks on your payroll to be legal. But most importantly for me, I think it's we need to change the mentality. This is not going to be fixed with just legislative technicalities. This has got to be changed with the mentalities of everybody in this country as to how serious we really want to take this issue.
This next question will start.
You gonna give me a chance to ask this guy?
Sorry, Jay.
Let me just say that I chaired the Senate committee. I chaired the Senate committee on immigration reform. It was Senate Bill 40. That bill was combined with House Bill 87 that eventually came out of the legislature. So, and it dealt with E-Verify. First thing we've got to do, just like everybody has said, we need to secure the borders. This administration has put us $5 trillion in debt, and they're telling us we cannot secure the borders. That is just crazy. We can secure the borders if we want to. The next thing we do need to do is issue visas. We need to issue visas in three different categories: construction, the service industry, and the food industry. We need to issue the visas there and charge these aliens, after they have registered and we give them a register number, we need to charge them at least $3,000 for this visa to work here for 3 to 5 years. That way we can cover our costs. But when it all comes down to it, the federal government has got to get on board. They've got to stop pounding this ping pong ball back and forth. But I think that's what we need to do and we can solve.
Thank you, Mr. Murphy. Sorry about that. All right, we'll start with Martha on this next question. Do you support raising taxes, and why or why not?
Very simple. We have a spending problem. We don't have a taxation problem. And, you know, it is amazing to me. We've been running in the last 15 years with these 10-year plans, okay, where you have all the cuts at the end and all the tax increases at the beginning. Well, the fact of the matter is, one Congress cannot be held, and the next Congress cannot be held to what this Congress does. So basically, we've been making 10-year plans, and nobody's been holding on to it. I mean, we've had debt going up every time. So the very simple answer to that is no, I do not support tax increases, because we have a spending problem, not a taxation problem.
Thank you, Steve.
Absolutely not. We have balanced our budget here in the state because it's constitutionally required. But when the economy was vibrant and we had plenty of cash flow coming in, we should have been paying off the debt, paying off the government. I mean, we should have been cutting costs and not growing government just because we had additional revenue coming in. A third of our Georgia DOT budget goes to paying off debt every year. The reason we have the road problems that we have is because we carry over $300 million in debt on the DOT. We should have been paying off all the different debt. We should have been cutting big government, and then we could have, when we hit these economic times that were hard, we would have been in much better shape and would have had the reserves and would have had the cash flow to maintain ourselves much better.
Well, I think it's obvious that our country and our state has a spending problem because everybody up here agrees. This is not about, we could double everybody's taxes, and I almost could guarantee you in 12 months, the government would find a way to spend it. This is a spending problem. This isn't a solution. It amazes me how little people move off the ball for cutting spending. We talk about little token projects here, little token projects there. What needs to happen is we don't need to move inches, we need to move miles at every level of government for spending. The intent of this government was to, by the founding fathers, was to be nowhere near as big as it is today. It was to be nowhere near as big as it is today. And it's costing us billions and trillions of dollars to run it. This is a spending problem, not a tax problem.
No, absolutely not. I don't believe in raising taxes. I haven't raised taxes in the 10 years I've served in the legislature. We need to watch our spending. We've watched it closely. We have cut our budget by $4 to $5 billion over the last 4 years out of the state. And we've done that by still maintaining a AAA bond rating. One of only eight states that has a AAA bond rating in the United States, and Georgia is one of them. I think we have cut the budget, we have watched our spending, and we're still watching it. Now, we've learned a valuable lesson during that time. We've learned that we can live without a lot of things that we don't need, just like families in this county has learned and families in this state have learned. They've learned that they can do without some things, and we've learned that same lesson. And we're going to continue to do that. Thank you.
I oppose raising taxes, but I want to go a little bit under that and tell you why I think we have the problem that continues to encourage us to raise taxes. Well, I want to go a little bit under it after saying that I'm opposed to raising taxes. I want to talk about why we keep doing that. We've voted for SWAS taxes in this county about 8 or 9 times that I can think of, for a variety of reasons. And I'm not opposed to sales taxes, but taxes in general. If you raise a tax, you ought to be reducing there should be an offset of somewhere for it, but we don't do that anymore. And we lost this whole game when we passed the 16th and 17th Amendment. 16th Amendment let the federal government go directly to you as an individual in your state and take the tax money right out of your pocket without having to get any permission from the state at all. State lost political clout. Same thing with the 17th, when we decided that we were going to go to direct election of U.S. senators instead of having the states have the political power to elect and pass them and then control that house like the framers intended. We wouldn't have Obamacare if we didn't have the 17th, because we just said, you go there and vote against Obamacare, and if you don't, we're going to remember, because we don't forget in between elections.
This next question is more of a local issue, one for me, so I'll be including this one. Steve, how should the current water dispute between the county and the city be resolved?
I think we all have to first recognize that we all live in this county, whether we're in the city limits or whether we're outside the city limits of the county. There's no reason to make this a profitable issue where the city sells water to the county. Certainly they need to cover their overhead, they have to cover their infrastructure. but this affects 175,000 people who are outside the city limits. And why this continues to happen and gets bogged down is a typical example of how government gets out of control. And once the power gets in there, they don't want to let go of it. We should be working together much better. The rates that we have for finished water should be cut substantially. We don't need as much finished water. The raw water rate, if it goes up, should go up minimally. And there should definitely be a cap on the CPI.
The one thing I will say is that the whole state's watching how we handle this problem. It's in the best interest of the city for the county to succeed. It's in the best interest of the county for the city to succeed long term. I'm of the opinion that we need to sit at the table and we need to talk about what's in the best interest of everybody in this county and in this city. I agree with Steve. We talk about raw water. We can get into all the finite details, but ultimately, it's in everybody's best interest to get this fixed. We should be able to do it. We've got some bright minds sitting in the room with a lot of data. It leads to some bigger issues that talk about water. Obviously, it seems like Forsyth County constantly has water coming up. We talk about the lake. We need to solve these problems because a lot of people are watching us. I feel like the pricing needs to be fair, and it should be easily measured. This contract that we're trying to negotiate, from my research, it's common across this country. We should be able to pull what fair market value is for this water, whether it's finished or whether it's raw. Thank you.
Being in this county 29 years, it seems like we've been having water issues between the city and the county forever. It seems like it comes up forever. I went to Washington twice and tried to talk to the Assistant Secretary of the Army, did talk to the Assistant Secretary of the Army, and actually co-opted the bill to raise the lake by 2 feet to help solve some of the problems. The city and the county needs to work the water problems out. They need to sit down at the table, get their water problems worked out, and give the citizens of this county the best rate that they can get for their water. It's simple as that, and I support that. We need to get the best rates we can for the water in this county, and we need to sit down and work it out. And the commissioners need to get together with the city, the mayor needs to get together with the commissioners and work this thing out and stop this foolishness. Thank you.
Yeah, I've been around here watching this same dog and pony show for a lot of years, and but I want to tell you what, there's one scam that's going on in the water arguments all across this state. And the real deal is that cities and counties make money on water that they produce. And the reason that they can is because they don't pay the real market value of that water that they take out of whatever the source is. And that's why that's their profit margin right there. If they were paying the true value for it, they'd soon find a way to find more customers. Number one, they wouldn't be so interested in beating other governments out, but they'd need customers if they were the only producer. Number two is that if you don't pay the fair value for it, what happens? You don't really care what happens to that water. And just like in the city of Atlanta, they were perfectly happy to continue to pay millions of dollars worth of fines because they didn't pay anything for the water coming out of the Chattahoochee, even though half of it was going into the ground because they wouldn't spend the money to fix their water pipes. So that tells you what part of the economic issue is with respect to providing water. The second thing is
All right, this next question, we'll start with Geoff. And again, Martha, this is a local question. What is your position on the loss split, and what will you do to ensure that the citizens of the county are receiving their fair share?
Well, once again, I think that we've got a big audience watching how we handle.
Thank you.
A lot of eyeballs on us on how we handle our business here. It is in the best interest, as I said a minute ago, for people in the city to see the people in the county succeed, and for people in the county want to see people in the city succeed. This has got to be a win-win for everybody involved. We talked about it. A lot of this was brought up at the county commissioners today that I attended. A lot of numbers were thrown up. It seemed like the number needed to be pared back into the single digits. I don't have my finger on the exact percentage, but I don't think there's any doubt that it needs to be fair across the board. And I think we can all, in the county commissioners today, I think it was very obvious that there was a fair number that came out. And I want to say the number was around 8%. Thank you.
Well, there again, I think the commissioners and the city, the mayor needs to get together with what they consider to be a fair split. I think they need to publish some kind of project list on what they're going to do. If you're going to give the city 8%, 9%, 10%, whatever you're going to give them, I think they need to publish a list on what they're going to do with the money. And of course, they've done some good things in the county with the money, and the commission has done some good things in the county with the part of the splosh that they've got. But that can be worked out. But I think as citizens and transparency, that we need to look and see what they're going to do with the projects with the splosh money when it comes out. Thank you.
One of the things I think that we might need or want to look at is that we have one city in this county, and there are some other counties who are in the same or similar circumstances. And so between the city and the county, we do a lot of things together. We drive on the road from the county into the city. The county sheriff's department does most of the police. All the emergency and fire departments by the county. The schools run all the county. So it's clear we have interest between those two geographical governmental entities. One of the things that's been done is they've merged, like they did in Athens-Clarke County, the city and the county. So to avoid the duplication of services and the additional cost from having two separate governments. So that may be something that we want to consider, both with regard to the water and also with regard to how we divide lost money, because I think that would probably be negotiated, a lot with a lot less controversy if we have a mutual interest that we can see.
Thank you.
Well, the loss is based on services and not population. So if it were based on population, it would certainly be much lower. The split is too high. It needs to be lower. The county provides a great many services to the city. I would like to go back to the water issue. The state EPD does permit the water that we can clean for the county. And with all the growth we've had in the last 10 years, we have not had a permit increase from the EPD since Senator Murphy's been down there for the last 10 years.
We'll start with Jack Murphy with this next question, and Martha, this question will be addressed for you as well. What is your position on Agenda 21 and why, and do you believe it's already here or coming to Forsyth County?
Well, I think there's still a lot of debate to be done on Agenda 21. I think that, there's still a lot of misunderstanding with Agenda 21. I think there is that it could be coming to Forsyth County. I think it needs to be looked at closer. And really, I don't have a strong opinion about it one way or the other right now. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Tom?
Too many working parts, and I'm opposed to it.
I was the first person in this race to come out against Agenda 21. It is creeping into many counties across this district and across this region. And it's covered up with words that sound nice, like sustainability and green and that kind of thing. And yeah, I believe conservatives are good environmentalists. We are good stewards of what we use. But the biggest battle, and I've been on record for more than 10 years, to say the biggest battle of the next 10 years are going to be what you want to do with your property versus what the government wants you to do with your property. And personal rights are the key to what makes America great, along with what the founding fathers put forth. So I have been opposed to Agenda 21. We have to fight it every path that we can, because it is the wrong way to go. for what we do. We cannot get away from personal property rights. And again, I address that in the Map for Prosperity. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve.
Well, I think many folks in the GOP think that Agenda 21 is very much for real. We passed a resolution at the state convention this past weekend, specifically about Agenda 21. And it is a UN charter. It is being slid into communities under many, many different names. And they're hoping that we're asleep and that we're not watching. And they're gonna try to take your property under different guises, all under sustainability or smart growth or many, many different things. They're not gonna come at you and call it what it is. You've got to be paying attention. We've got to be vigilant in our efforts to keep an eye on this.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm against Agenda 21. There was a great, the Tea Party hosted an event a couple of months ago that was a great seminar that talked about Agenda 21 and laid it out in extreme detail. And of course, being in the building business, I see it more so than probably the average small business owner, because we see it through building codes, we see it through development techniques through various cities and counties across North Georgia that my company operates in. When it really came to life for me was we're working on a project for a gentleman that is a government compliance officer for a Fortune 500 company, and he has direct relations with the United Nations. His comment to me was Agenda 21 is coming like a freight train, and we need to be able to stand up against it. Thank you.
All right, thank you. We'll start with Tom for the next question. Do you support term limits for elected officials? Why or why not?
I do. I think we have one of the best term limits in the free world. It's called elections. And everybody that goes down there can be unelected. Everybody who's elected can be unelected. I think that allows you to keep the good ones and get rid of the bad ones if you want to. And it also puts the responsibility for that directly on the people who it should be on, and that's the voters. I don't think there's a system that's any better than that.
I do support term limits. I believe there should be no more than 12 years that you serve in a federal office, a combination of Congress and Senate. I think no more than two terms for the Senate, no more than three terms for the House. We've got to do that. But right now, the term limits are you as elective, as people in the electorate. That is the people that are there, and that's what's going to do that. But I do support term limits. But not only, and Tom Graves puts this idea out there, and he's absolutely right about it. Not only do you need term limits for the elected officials, but you need term limits for the bureaucrats. You know, and some would say, okay, but you can't move somebody from agriculture over to transportation. I would say, why not? The problem is not the engineers and those kinds of folks. The problem are the policy people. And when they stay in one department for 25 or 30 years, their tentacles go down and they control things much more. And as a part of that, Congress needs to assert more of its power. It has given up so much power, and it is a co-equal branch of government. So that is part of that. So yes, I do support term limits.
I definitely support term limits. I think it's obvious why we need to have that. I think the bureaucrats also need to have term limits. The elections do not work as a term limit. I think we have to accept the fact that there's very few incumbents that get voted out, and it's primarily because special interests fund them at such a high level of contributions and lobbying money that it's very, very difficult for a citizen to run against an incumbent and to vote them out. It takes an extreme measure for that to happen. So term limits is an easy solution to that problem.
Yeah, absolutely, I support term limits. Let me give you some perspective. So first time running for office, I've got my eyes wide open as to how this process works. The first question just about everybody asks me is there an incumbent? It's a challenge. If you're running against an incumbent, it's a challenge. In my particular race, so far to this point through our disclosures, 92% of the dollars raised have been from special interests or corporations for my opponent. That's the mountain you've got to climb if you're willing to fight this fight. I don't have a problem with lobbyists by any means, but I also don't have a problem with going out with folks here in this district, asking for their energy, asking for their time, and asking for their vote.
I'm going to back up just a second. Let me say something about Agenda 21. As long as the United Nations is involved in it, I'm not in support of it, because I don't support the United Nations on just about anything they do. Another thing about my opponent, Mr. Voshall, said something about the EPD. I don't control the EPD. The federal government controls the EPD in this state. As far as term limits goes, I would support term limits if we could get the terms extended for the House and the Senate in the state for 4 years. I'd be glad to support term limits if we could do that. Thank you.
All right, thank you. The next question, we'll start with Martha. Do you support campaign finance reform, and what specifically would you like to see within that reform?
You know, that's a tough one, because I do believe that money in a campaign is speech. And I agree with the Supreme Court decision, the Citizens United decision, that money is speech. But I think that the problem is that we have got to have more transparency. I'm probably going to shock y'all. I think there should be no limits in what people can give to campaigns, but you ought to have your name attached to it, not some organization's name attached to it. That if Sheldon Adelson wants to give $15 million to Newt Gingrich, and he went out there and said, I'm giving $15 million to Newt Gingrich, fine. That's what he ought to be allowed to do. That's well and good. But I think when you have organizations in there, and that's what we're dealing with right now, we've got a lot of organizations that are out there, and hey, I'm having to work in that system, and I'm following the law. But I do believe that campaign money is speech, and that it ought to be as transparent as possible. There's no reason why we should have quarterly filings. We ought to be able to every day tell what we got and who we got it from. And then you ought to be able to make your decisions based on that.
Yeah, for a businessman who is running for the first time, it's the compliance and the transparency and the rules and the regulations. I mean, you literally have to spend an entire class. You have to hire an attorney to maintain all this. And the rules generally get built to benefit people who are making the rules. They're not necessarily there to help people who are trying to run for the office. I think there needs to be some changes to it. I think there should be different levels for different races. The smaller races shouldn't have as high of a cap as a presidential race. It becomes almost unattainable for a normal person to run for office and to raise those kind of funds with the limits that we have, and with the ability to the marketing machine of the special interest, the PACs, and the lobbyists.
As I said in my last answer, running for office, this has been an eye-opening experience for me. It has blown me away at the process. I spent a couple days down at the Capitol during this past legislative session just trying to get my feet wet, just trying to understand a little bit more about how the process works, and there was one experience that just blew me away. Was walking through the center atrium towards the tail end of the session, and there was in the hundreds of lobbyists with their backs against the wall, all with their name tags on. Got nothing against lobbyists at all. They're there to inform people. But something didn't feel right about that moment of walking out just mere feet away from our state legislators with hundreds of lobbyists there. There's been a recent issue that obviously, thank goodness, has now going to come to vote on July 31st with ethics reform, where we talk about that. And it needs to be addressed without a shadow of a doubt. Thank you.
I believe in some, what we need to have is some more transparency so you can see who's giving you money. But this is a free country. I can't tell you how to spend your money. You make your money, you can spend your money like you want to. If you want to give me $10 for my campaign, or you want to give me $2,000 for my campaign, that is up to you, not up to me. It's a free country. I don't think we should start telling people how they need to spend their money, and where they need to spend their money, and who they need to spend their money on. Thank you.
Well, I think there's always a room for improvement in campaign laws and other laws that we pass. As far as special interest concerned, you're right, there are a lot of special interests. We have a special interest that represent teachers. We have special interests that represent doctors. We have special interests that represent stay-at-home moms. We have special interests that represent the Cancer Society, and on and on and on. And most of you belong to a whole bunch of those. We also have a special interest called a voter who comes to see us and asks us to do this or that in a particular bid. The difference between them and a lobbyist is a lobbyist gets paid by a whole bunch of people to do the same thing. So if you want to look at it this way, think about this. How do you get equality in campaign contributions? You don't. If you're running against a billionaire, should you be able to take a contribution from somebody that puts you even with the billionaire? Because he can spend every nickel he's got at once on that campaign. If you don't have to be a billionaire, you do have a problem unless enough people are willing to give you the money to run a race against them. That's just the hard facts of it. Politics, just like everything else in life, costs money.
All right, we'll start the next question with Steve. Give us a list of the first three things that you would work on if you were elected.
Lobbying and limits, number one. Jobs and lowering taxes. And not in that order.
For me, jobs, definitely. We need jobs, J-O-B-S's. That's exactly what we need, and I would definitely look at lowering taxes. And I would ultimately look, a lot of people ask, what's the first thing you're gonna do if you get elected? What's the first piece of legislation you're gonna put forward? The first thing I wanna do is remove legislation that puts yokes around every small business owner in this state, in this county, and in my district.
Is number one that we need to work on. We need to work on less regulations for these businesses. You know, about 85% of our businesses are small businesses, and we are regulating them out of business. And we need to stop that. We need to look at every regulation that we've got in the state and do away with the ones that we can do away with. Of course, most of them is dictated to by the federal government, and of course, with the administration we've got up there right now, it's going to be kind of hard to change that. We need to do away with all the regulations we can and put people back to work in this state and get them back out here so they can feed their families and work and raise their children and live the life that they're supposed to lead. Thank you.
First thing I do is make sure we have legislation to prevent the state from facilitating anything to do with Obamacare. The second thing would be to have the state cut spending. I'm talking about cut spending. The third thing that I do is pass legislation to help the state cut spending. I'm talking about cutting spending. That's all we got to do. Reach it up, and that's going to take care of itself.
Well, when President Romney signs into law the Keystone Pipeline, put an energy policy that's going to be in place that's going to give American energy for American workers. I'm also going to advocate for cut, cap, and balance, which is what we have to do to get spending under control. Also, we're going to repeal Obamacare, and with the help of a Republican Senate and a Republican president, and put in place, I hope, Paul Brown's 51-page health care bill that everybody can understand. It's a free market solution. And then finally, the fair tax. And again, I'm like Steve, not necessarily that in that order, but the two things that are going to make the biggest change in how our businesses can grow is to have a fair tax and an energy policy that is going to open up the doors for cheap energy in America.
What incentives do you feel are appropriate to entice business to the state, region, and district?
We're in a position here in the state of Georgia, we'll talk in Georgia terms here for a minute, where we have an incredibly strong opportunity when this economy turns to jump out in front of many places around this country. The port that we've got currently handles, I believe it's less than 4,000 shipments a day, has the capacity to go to over 8,000 shipments a day. The incentives we need to put forward are a lot like the Kia plant. We talk about the Kia plant and those jobs that are down there. Those jobs, there's derivative benefits from, second derivative benefits from bringing folks in by cutting sales tax for equipment purchases, by talking about local taxes for those businesses. The jobs that are created, we measured, I think Jack mentioned it a bit about earlier, 1,500 jobs for the Caterpillar plant that comes in. What we don't mention are the tons of other jobs that come in from the other vendors. So I support the current line of efforts that we're putting forward, but at the end of the day, we need to put the best and brightest minds in those boardrooms all over this country to get them to come to Georgia to do business.
Well, one thing we passed this last session was to give a break on energy to the manufacturers in this state. Now, that was passed for one reason. That was passed to make us competitive with other states to bring needed industry into this state where they knew they could get a break on their energy taxes and employ a lot more people in the state. So that was something that we needed to do. That was something that was in the package that was sorely needed. The Kia plant is a prime example, like Geoff mentioned. There is so much collateral businesses that come from the Kia plant in the where they make the seats, the where they make the upholstery. I went down and visited that, and there was at least 10 other businesses associated around the Kia plant. That is the kind of industry that we need in this state.
I'm not a big fan of these so-called enticements to get businesses to come to the state. A lot of times that costs more to get them than it actually ends up providing to the state. I think people come to this, businesses come to a state that has a strong economy, a good workforce, and lower regulations. If we have a strong economy, we have lower regulations, we're a business-friendly state. Those folks will come here.
The best thing the federal government can do to incentivize jobs is to cut cap and balance the budget, get the tax code straightened out, get the energy code straightened out, and get job-killing regulations out of the way. I meet people every day that are intentionally not growing their businesses. People who have good businesses that could grow their businesses, that are intentionally not growing their businesses because of the regulations and the tax code. How many jobs are being lost every day because of that? Every day I talk to somebody who's doing something like that. Martha, I could grow my business, except if I go to 25 people or 20 people or 15 people, regulations are going to kick in. So if the federal government does its job, it is job one. If they do its job, then Georgia can do its job to bring jobs into Georgia.
Thank you, Connie, Steve.
Well, first, we need to be business friendly, and we need to be competitive with our neighboring states. Less regulation, less state debt, and cutting the budget so that they know that when they come here that we're fiscally sound, that we are truly conservative, and that we run our state government the way they want to run their business. Energy incentives are good for your large businesses, but if we can turn our state budget around and pay down the debt and get ahead of the game, then we're going to be the state that businesses are going to want to move to. And we'll be able to lower taxes for those businesses.
Thank you, Steve. All right, Jack, we'll start with you with the last question of the evening. What is your position on school vouchers as well as your position on charter schools?
I have voted for school vouchers and I voted for the charter schools. I tell you why I agree with the charter schools, which we don't have a problem with in Passaic County. We've got an excellent school system here. So really there, it's not a discussion too much here in Passaic County. But let's just say that I'm in a district and I live, say, a mile away. My school, my kid is going to an excellent school system. They changed the district and all of a sudden my child is in a school system to where it is not a good school system. Should I have that opportunity as a parent and as a citizen to let my kid go to a charter school? Should I have that opportunity and be afforded that opportunity? I think I should. I think that that would be up to, I want the best education for my child, so I'm a supporter of charter schools.
Thank you. I support charter schools and vouchers because they both are based on free enterprise capitalist system that works really well because it provides competition. Whether you're good, bad, or indifferent, you need to have competition. And that's what vouchers and charter schools do. Look, who's the consumer? Who's the consumer in education? Is it the children? Is it the parents? And then who pays the bill? The taxpayers pay the bill, but the consumers don't have any responsibility for the payment under the current system. When you go to a charter school or you go to you have a voucher, you've got responsibility for the money that you're paying. And if you don't get what you're supposed to get, you're going to go somewhere else with it. That's exactly the way it ought to work. There's no reason why it can't. And anybody that doesn't want to do that doesn't have to. They can go to the county schools or whatever schools there are. But I think this is absolutely the way to go to meet the education industry that we have.
Martha, you can expand that to the Department of Education on a national level.
Yeah, I mean, I support the ending of the Department of Education. It's a state and local function. And as a parent, a mother of four children, you know, I support school choice. In Hall and Jackson County, we have an incredible situation where we have created a competitive environment because, you know, Gainesville City Schools, Beaufort City Schools, and Jackson City Schools, where people can choose to go to that school system. So as a result of that, the public schools and the private schools have become a lot more competitive in those two counties, and competition is good. So I think we should have competition in public schools, private schools, parochial schools. It should all be on the table, and the choice should be the parents. You know, somebody tries to tell you, oh, well, the kids that have school choice, they don't do as well, but they behave better, and their parents are happier. Well, I don't know about your house, but in my house, if mama's happy, everybody's happy. And so we want the parents to be happier. So I support ending the federal Department of Education, putting it back on the local level, and yes, having school choice, whether you want to call it charter schools or vouchers, having school choice.
Our children's number one priority in ours is a good education. Throwing more money at a bad school system or at a bad school just doesn't work. I support charters and vouchers, and I think that it provides competition and makes the system earn our tax dollars by providing us with a quality system. And knowing full well that if they don't, that we'll go elsewhere. I think it just makes sense.
I've got three kids. You got to see two of them, and the other ones, they both go to Davis Creek Elementary here in the county, and my little guy will end up going there here in a couple of years. So education is really, really important to me. Vouchers and charters, absolutely I'm for. We are very blessed that we live in the county that we do, because we don't need vouchers and we don't need charter schools. We are absolutely blessed. I know every teacher that has worked with my sons, and I could be no more impressed with the level of education that my kids get in the public education system here in Forsyth. One of the first stops I made when I decided to run for office was to go see Dr. Evans. Dr. Evans is our school superintendent, and we are absolutely blessed to have a man like that running our school system. I made a stop. I wanted to find out what his perspective was, what his outlook was. And it's bright. It's absolutely bright. Competition has never hurt anybody. And so I have 4 vouchers and I have 4 charters.
All right, thank you, everybody. That was the last question. So what we're going to close with now are our closing statements. And we'll reverse the order from where we started. So we'll start with Geoff. I'm sorry, 1 second. Justin, we'll start with you. All right.
Well, it was a great opportunity to sit and hear from all those candidates, and we heard quite a lot of different positions and ideas, and I want to thank them for being here tonight. Thank you all for listening to me for my total of 5 minutes. It's been well worth the investment of time. I think, unlike what was said earlier tonight, we do have a spending problem in this country, but we also have a tax problem in this country. That's one of the key issues that the Tea Party stands for, is reducing the tax burden, reducing the intrusion of the federal government into our wallets. Doug Collins is the candidate that will stand firm on the fiscal issues. He will also stand firm on the family values issues that matter so much to all of us. The liberals are out there to undermine our families at every turn, and we cannot let that happen. I'm humbled to be here tonight on behalf of Doug. I ask you to go to our website and look it up, collinsleads.com. Thank you so much for the opportunity to be here, and have a wonderful night.
Thank you, Jim.
Once again, I want to thank everybody for coming tonight. This experience has allowed me to understand that the battleground for democracy is no longer in Washington. It's at the state and local level. My wife and I didn't take this decision to run for office very lightly, because for us, this is not just about winning an election. This is about creating a movement that puts our kids' generation in front of our generation. We have 3 primary items that we push in every single opportunity we have for our campaign: family, faith, and quality jobs. We are about family. The decisions we need to make, the $16 trillion worth of debt, is not good for our families. My faith is important to me, not as a means to shove it down your throat, but as a means to show you by example as to how important my integrity and my character is to each and every decision that I make. Quality jobs is code language for free markets. I'm anxious to get back to talking about not just getting this country back to where it was at 4 years ago, but making it better than it's ever been before. This race is not about Tom Knox, and it's not about Geoff Duncan. It's about you and your families. I want to thank everybody for their support, and you can see us at Duncan2012.com. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Steve.
First, I want to thank the Forsyth County Tea Party for organizing this event, and I want to thank each candidate for showing up tonight and taking questions from the citizens. Secondly, I want to thank my family and my friends for being in support of me in this endeavor. Tonight, you've heard some differences between myself and my opponent, Senator Murphy. I believe I have the knowledge, leadership, and ethical qualities that we need for the person to represent our county and citizens as the next state senator. If elected, I will ethically represent Forsyth County and help stop political cronyism that is rampant in the state of Georgia and in our country. I want to represent the citizens of Forsyth County and not the special interest of those who would feed off the taxpayer. A leader leads by example. As a state senator and an elected official, you represent the entire county. You are in a position of leadership, and you should hold yourself to a higher level of accountability. I'm a supporter of term limits, and Senator Murphy has been in the legislature for 10 years. In the last 4 years, Georgians have suffered greatly with high unemployment, foreclosures, and a decimated construction industry. When you have a team that goes 1-9 4 years in a row, it's time to change the coaching staff. I ask you for your support and vote on July 31st to take back our Senate seat for the people of Forsyth County.
Thank you, Martha.
I'm Martha Zoller, and I've been your conservative voice for the last 15 years. And this election is a choice between a conservative firebrand and a professional politician that thinks it's his turn. It's very important that we make a good choice in this. And with all due respect to all the state legislators that are in this room, the federal government is full of state legislators that balanced budgets when they were in the state house, but haven't passed a single balanced budget since they've been in the Congress. And I think we need to do something different. The definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. And we have to put different people up there. I also want to say too, you know, that the founding fathers had never been in government before. They had never passed laws before, most of them. Most of them have been different kind of business people. They brought different kinds of perspective. And they put together a Declaration of Independence and a Constitution that is the best document that has ever governed man, other than the Bible. and it is something that is worth fighting for. So I ask you today for your vote on July 31st. Go to markitforcongress.com and get involved in this conservative firebrand movement, and then we will change our country, because it's time to put our country back on track. And I thank you for your time. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom.
We need to put our state and our country back on track. We've lost our way over the last 50, 75, 100 years. And what we need to start doing is exactly what the socialists preach ought to be done. And right here in Georgia, we have to start it. And it's not going to be a big thing. It always starts with small things, and a lot of them. And that is, we've got to talk to our neighbors and our friends, our relatives, and we've got to start talking about what the real issues are. Stop listening to people with campaign talking points. Let's us start by showing Georgia to be the model for how it can be, because we can do it here. We've got one of the best economies and one of the best run governments of all the 50 states. So we've got a good place to start. Then we've got to get rid of Obama. And then we have to repeal the 16th and 17th Amendment, because all the stuff we're talking about is not going to continue, will not help us over the long haul as long as they can keep beating us up. With the 60, there is no monitor on them. There's nothing keeping them down as long as they can get away with what they're doing without the 16th and 17th Amendment. The framers put it in for a good reason. We need to put it back there, and you're going to see how quick things start changing around.
Jerry. Well, I want to recognize my biggest supporter in the audience, and that's my wife, Linda, sitting there. She's been kind of giving me the, go sign or whatever, do this debate. Let me correct a couple of things that Steve has said. According to him, I am responsible for the whole economic failure of the state of Georgia. Out of the 236 legislators down there, the governor and the lieutenant governor, it's all on my shoulders. I was responsible for that. And he said that the last 3 or 4 years, I've been chairman of banking. Well, my math is not all that great, but I was elected, put into chairmanship in January of 2011. Now, before January 2011, there was 41 bank failures in this state, and they started in 2007. Now, I'm not, sometimes it takes me a while to catch up, but I'm not sure that I could have prevented 41 bank failures when I'm not there. I couldn't prevent the 78 bank failures. I'm a state senator. The FDIC, Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, is the one to close these banks, not me. If I had that responsibility, I wouldn't be here running for Senate. I'd be running for president if I could stop that. So, that's just ludicrous to say that I could stop 78 bank failures. But I appreciate you being here. I happen to believe Georgia is a great state. I happen to believe Passaic County is the best county in this state. And it's been my privilege to serve you, and I would appreciate your support when it comes to election time. Thank you.
Okay, I would like to thank all of the candidates for being here tonight on behalf of the Forsyth County Tea Party. We're glad you came to speak to the citizens, and we're also thankful that the audience showed up to listen to what these candidates had to say firsthand. It's an important election that's coming up in July, and then the general election in November, so I would urge you and everyone that you can get out to vote to do so, and let's keep this democracy running. Thank you very much. And the next Tea Party meeting is on June 18th, so please come and see what we're all about. Thank you.
As always.
like one of the other capital meeting.
Thank you.